You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, yesterday I didn't get finished with what we were doing here, and I was reading to you from an article, and it's called Chiapas and Montana. It's let me see. Let me find the. Let me make sure that you know all about this thing, just in case you're catching the tail end of it. Chiapas and Montana by James Murray. And this article appeared in a book called Race Traitor. I cannot stand racism in any form. It is a plague, a blight upon humanity. It is responsible for most of the pain and heartache and bloodshed that's ever been perpetrated in the history of this earth. And it's all mixed in with religion and the concept of a master race and a whole bunch of other baloney. And that's exactly what it is, ladies and gentlemen, baloney. People are just people. Doesn't matter what color they are. Doesn't matter their ancestral origin. It doesn't, you know, it just doesn't matter. Here is what they believe, and I'm reading this directly from the magazine. It says, the white race is a historically constructed social formation. It consists of all those who partake of the privileges of the white skin in this society. Its most wretched members share a status higher in certain respects than that of the most exalted persons excluded from it, in return for which they give their support to a system that degrades them. And here's their solution. The key to solving the social problems of our age is to abolish the white race. That chance, you know. I can't understand how they can get away with making a statement like that. You know, if somebody just even alludes to damaging any of the other races, there is the biggest hue and cry that you've ever seen in your life. Now, in case you think I'm some white supremacist here spouting nonsense, you're full of nonsense. I'm part Native American. I'm married to a 100% full-blood Chinese woman, and I have spent most of my life fighting racism in all of its various forms. And the reason I'm reading this is it's an article about the militia and the Zapatistas down in Mexico, and it's comparing the two. And I finished most of the article yesterday, all but two pages, which I'm going to finish right now. So if you missed it, order yesterday's tape. You can order any tape of any broadcast of the Hour of the Time just by specifying the date and or the subject. But the date is the primary importance. So remember the date. Yesterday was January the 5th. And so if you want to order that tape, order January the 5th. And you can order them simply by writing to Harvest Trust, P.O. Box 2470, Pine Top, Arizona, 85935. I don't remember what the tape's price are, folks. Send us a dollar in a self-addressed stamped envelope, and somebody will send you back a complete list of tapes and all the prices and catalog and all that stuff. Or you can find out real quick just by going to our webpage. It's harvest-trust.org. harvest-trust.org. Once again, here's the address for Harvest Trust. Harvest Trust, P.O. Box 2470, Pine Top, Arizona, 85935. Now, this broadcast is not a commercial broadcast. We don't sell stuff on this broadcast. I'm just telling you that as a service. This broadcast and the station are actually run by a non-profit charitable trust, the Independence Foundation Trust. If you want to write to the broadcast, it's a different address altogether. It's HOT, H-O-T-T. That stands for the Hour of the Time. HOT, H-O-T-T. In care of 101.1 FM. That's 101.1 FM. P.O. Box 940. That's P.O. Box 940. Eager, spelled E-A-G-A-R, Arizona, 85925. That's HOT. HOT stands for Hour of the Time. In care of 101.1 FM, P.O. Box 940. That's P.O. Box 940. Eager, spelled E-A-G-A-R, Arizona, 85925. So if you want to write to the broadcast or about the broadcast, or you want your letter read on the broadcast, that's the address you should use. If you want to know about Harvest Trust and what they've got to offer, write to Harvest Trust, ask them to send you a complete catalog, and they handle the tapes for these broadcasts, because the charitable trust cannot. Okay? That's the way it goes. Okay, let me finish what we started yesterday, and this is just the last two pages, and it's going to go real quick. It's just the very end of the article. Quote, and this is the start of the of where we left off. The militia's grass-rooted non-organization makes it impossible to believe they could agree among themselves long enough to ever set up any revolutionary government structure above the county level. All the better. We have no need to fear another Aryan Republic. The militias will never overthrow the government in the vanguardist style. However, it is within the realm of possibility that they could very well make large portions of North America ungovernable. Whether one would favor such a non-state of affairs depends to a large degree on how much one has to lose. The residents of Starr County, Texas, South Central Los Angeles, and Northern Idaho might agree it would be an improvement. The tactics of the United States and Mexican governments toward their homegrown rebels have been identical. The United States Justice Department has used a strategy to combat the militias, which it employed to great success in the crises of 1968 to 1972. The aim is to get the leadership of the movement under federal indictment regardless of guilt. This tactic attempts to freeze the leadership and forces the movement to expend resources and slow down its operations. As of January 1997, there were 36 cases pending in the United States against supposed militia groups for a variety of plots. Many, if not most, of these cases are the result of FBI sting operations and represent little more than the feds taking out the easy marks, the gullible, the insane, the idiotic, in the so-called militia milieu. The Mexican government has attempted the same maneuvers, albeit at a much lower level of sophistication. They have also attempted the charade of official negotiations with the Zapatistas, negotiations which seem to be perpetually on again, off again. These negotiations are intended to re-engage the EZLN into the official democratic process and isolate them from their popular support among moderate status. These negotiations are roughly analogous to the 1994 congressional elections in the United States, in which the media gave much attention to the supposed anti-government revolution led by Newt Gingrich and his crew of sky god-fearing stooges. These tactics have failed, both in the United States and Mexico. The Zapatistas have consolidated their movement and been joined by several other guerrilla bands, all opposing the elite controllers of Mexican society. And despite the terror of the Oklahoma City bombing, the militias have grown as well, with the added serious awareness on the part of the participants that involvement in militia units can get one killed or sentenced to life in a federal gulag. But even with that shared knowledge, the militias have grown and spread their web, far from falling into stunned disarray like the anarchists post-Haymark of the radicals post-Kent State liberals who couldn't make it work. The militias have grown stronger under open oppression. At this point, the Zapatistas and the militias look remarkably similar. Hounded by security forces, patronized by politicians, these women and men appear to be revolutionaries, settling in for a long haul. In late October 1996, United States Representative Maxine Walters spoke on national public radio concerning the then-breaking story of the CIA Contra cocaine scheme. She said, African Americans were perhaps, quote, behind the curve, end quote, on what was really happening in America. She said people all over the country were, quote, waking up, end quote, to what had been portrayed in the media as, quote, angry white middle-aged male syndrome, end quote. Perhaps 40-plus years of police state repression is coming home to roost in Mexico, South Central Los Angeles, the Rocky Mountains, and the Great Plains. The expressions will be diverse and rooted in local culture. The strains will not be synonymous. No single big theory unites them. Those of us who continue to dream and work toward the emergence of revolutionary situations welcome them all, even if we do not wish to actively sign up for any of them, for these are the expressions of the monolith cracking. End of article. That's written by a man who wants to exterminate the white race and his an extreme left-wing Marxist radical liberal social revolutionary. So, if the far left is beginning to give credence and recognition to the militia movement, somebody in Washington, D.C. had better start doing the same. Because I'm here to tell you, they're deadly serious. How do I know? Because, folks, I'm one of them. If you want to write down this number, ladies and gentlemen, please do so now, because I'm going to open the phones as soon as this number is over, and all I want to know is the reception better at this earlier time on shortwave than it was at the later time? In other words, at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, are you receiving the hour of the time better than you were at 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time? It's really important to me to find that out, because I'm trying to put the show in the slot that allows the listeners to hear it the best. No problem in South America, Australia, all through the Caribbean islands, portions of South America, and even some places in Europe, I understand, receiving the broadcast loud and clear. And I've heard that within the next couple of weeks, the new antenna is going to be operating at full strength, so that should change things dramatically. The number is 520-333-4578. 520-333-4578. And all I want to know, folks, is if you can hear the broadcast, and is it better? You know, just give me a reception report, if you will. If not, I got plenty of things here to talk about. Does it? There is a war. For those of you who have been paying attention, we're in the middle of World War III, and the stakes are pretty high. I need reception reports from those of you listening on shortwave. If there's anybody listening on shortwave, there usually is, even if they can't hear for some reason. The number is 520-333. That wasn't supposed to happen. Evidently, I pushed the wrong button. The number is 333-4578. That's 520-333-4578. I need a reception report. I need to know how well you're receiving the hour of the time. And if you're not, I need to know that. But if you're not, you're not even going to know that I'm asking this, and you're not going to know the phone number. So that's sort of a moot thing, isn't it? How many of you are paying attention to the financial situation around the world? I know not many are. Most of you just go about your daily business as if nothing is happening. How many of you have been watching the swings in the stock market? I mean, even if you watch the news or communist news networks, you can't help but at least see some of those things. We'll get to that in just a minute. Good evening. You're on the air.
Less than a minute here. I'm picking you up loud and clear on 9955 here in Miami, Florida, at this time, 8 o'clock, and at the later time, Eastern Standard Time.
We're not on at the later time.
Okay, well, I've been hearing you two times at night, Monday through Friday night now.
Two times?
Clear at 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time.
Okay, when did you didn't hear us at 8 o'clock last week, did you?
Yes, sir, I did.
They've been doing us two times every day?
Yes, sir, it was. I think once at 11 o'clock at night as well.
Yeah, that's the time we were supposed to be at. Huh.
At 8 o'clock. Sir, I'm calling from a calling card, but I am picking you up loud and clear. I didn't have much time left here.
Okay, I'm sorry.
That's okay. I hope to keep hearing you again and again.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Have a good night.
You too. Well, Miami, Florida, picking us up loud and clear. That's unusual because the station is in Miami, Florida, and it's very difficult to hear shortwave if you're close to the station. So that's good. Good evening. You're on the air. Hello?
Yes. You got Dusty from Minnesota?
Yes, Dusty.
Yeah, I'm picking you up. You are somewhat better than the later time.
Good. Are you hearing the broadcast okay?
Yeah, it's very tough to see that they're, from what I understand, their antenna is pointed towards the South America.
Yes, it is, but within a week or two, it's going to swing and point directly toward Matamoros, Mexico. And we can also swing it and point it directly at Toronto.
Uh-huh.
So, and it's going to be a full strength, 50,000 watts, and that's going to improve things dramatically.
Okay.
But we want the rest of the world to hear this broadcast. This is an international, worldwide broadcast.
Right.
The reason being is that if we go down the tubes, it means enslavement for the whole human race, not just the people in the United States of America.
Right. But I just wanted to tell you that you are better than your second. I believe it's a repeat broadcast.
No, we shouldn't even be on at 11 o'clock now. If they're doing that, they're giving us a freebie.
Yeah, it's a repeat.
It's okay with me.
All right, I'll let you go.
Okay, thanks. Thank you, Dusty, for your report. Yeah, gosh, Wisconsin and Miami, that's good. Anybody else out there listening? I'd appreciate a report from somewhere up around the Northeast, the Northwest, somewhere in the Great Plains. And if we can just get those three reports, we won't need to do this anymore. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, hello. Mr. Cooper?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is Pete from Miami. I work for WRMI. And I'm at home right now listening to your show, and I'm picking you up really good.
Great.
Yeah.
Are they really playing our broadcast twice?
Yeah. We're playing you at 8, and then we play again at 11.
Well, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
Good.
Okay.
Tell Jeff I said thanks.
I will.
Okay.
Pico says hi, too.
Thank you.
All right. Bye.
Hey, that's nice, folks. We're paying for one broadcast and getting two. That's really good. Thank you, WRMI. That's, I guess we have some allies there. And, well, we should if they believe in freedom, as we do. For all people of all religions and all ancestral points of origin. And if the whole world doesn't learn that real quick, it's going to disintegrate back into the Dark Ages. Just seems to be an unwritten law. Okay, back to the market. For those of you who have been just tuning in to the Communist News Networks, you can't help hearing the stock market report every once in a while. And I'm sure that some of you tune it out because maybe you don't have investments, but you better listen to it because what's happening in the stock market in this country and around the world is going to have a great effect upon you sometime in the very near future. Whether you are aware of it or not, the economies of the Asian nations are disintegrated. Well, I was going to say disintegrating, and I said disintegrated. That's sort of a flip, but it's true. They have disintegrated. They are in the process of complete and total collapse. Now, the Japanese are trying very hard to maintain some sort of order and stability, and I have to give them credit for lasting this long, but they're also going down the tubes. And when you see, keep an eye on the Nikkei exchange in Japan, when you see it go below 14,000, you had better take that as a drastic warning, because when it hits 13,000, and it will, the markets in this country will collapse. They will go down the tubes. Now, there's not going to be a depression, ladies and gentlemen, like the Great Depression of the 20s and 30s. It's not going to happen, because they have a better control of the economy than they did then, and it's all paper. Paper can be manipulated. It's either paper, or it's electronic, or it's just a bookkeeping entry. That stuff can be manipulated. So when things start getting tough, what they'll do is just print more money, or create more credit, or just create more bookkeeping entries. Now, in case you don't understand what that means, if you look at the German Weimar Republic right after World War I and look at the tremendous inflation that occurred there, that's what's going to happen, because that is the result of printing more money, making credit more readily available, and then creating more bookkeeping entries. So that's what created the rapid inflation in the 70s. Remember in the 70s and then again in the early 80s, when all of a sudden there was just all this money available everywhere and prices started going up, and they blamed it on the oil shortage? Well, folks, history has proven there was no oil shortage. And those of us who understand how economies work knew that that was a scam when they told us that, because a shortage of a commodity does not create inflation. No, folks, it can't. It is absolutely impossible. A shortage of commodity just creates the shortage of that commodity, and the price fluctuates according to supply and demand of that commodity. And it may affect some things that are used in the manufacture of that commodity. But if you'll remember correctly, homes went from $25,000 to $45,000, literally overnight. Had nothing to do with the price of oil. Automobiles, everything. And the truth is, there was no oil shortage. Well, how did that happen? It happened, folks, because the man that you all thought was the greatest guy in the history of the presidency of the United States, Ronald Reagan, kept increasing government to the size and spending money way beyond the ability of anybody to pay for it at enormous interest rates. He was borrowing money on the full faith and credit of the United States of America, issuing bonds. And where do you think that money was going? It was going out into the economy. In other words, Ronald Reagan printed money on a scale that's never been done before in the history of this country. That's what really created the inflation of the 70s and the 80s. Don't believe it? Well, go back and look at it for yourself with open eyes. Get rid of all your prejudices and all of that kind of stuff. Why did everybody love Ronald Reagan? Well, it wasn't because of the jokes he told on television or during his press conferences, ladies and gentlemen, although that sort of helped. You know, you can't help but kind of like the funny guy, right? Everybody liked Ronald Reagan because he pumped money into the economy and money was available for anybody that wanted it. It's the greed factor. It had nothing to do with Ronald Reagan or his personality or his presidency or anything else. It had to do with the fact that when Ronald Reagan was president, you could get all the money you wanted really easily from any place that you wanted it. But that's the truth. Now you're all paying for it. Now you're all paying for it, and you're still praising Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan spent more money during his presidency than the combined total spending of every single president this nation has ever had in its entire history. He took the American dream away from young couples today who can't even afford to purchase a home now. Think about it. You know why your wife and your oldest children also have to go to work now, today? When before the Ronald Reagan presidency, folks, guess what? The head of the household could hold out a job and support the whole family, usually with no problem. I'm talking about middle class families. Lower middle class, medium middle class, and upper middle class family had it made in this country. Until Ronald Reagan came along, and poor people and young people just starting out had the promise of the opportunity that they too could have it made, but not anymore. And pretty soon, nobody's going to have it made because they're going to pull the rug right out from under you. You see, the Asian economies cannot fail without bringing down this economy also. Now, I've had people laugh in my face when I've told them that. Yet they go to Walmart, and they can be there all day long, and they're lucky if they can find three items in the whole store that was made in the United States of America. And of all of the ones that are made in foreign countries, most of them are made in Asian countries. Or the parts were made in Asian countries, and they're shipped to places like Mexico where they're assembled. Check it out. And the next time you lift the hood of your Dodge or your Plymouth, check out what name is on the engine. Yep, that's right. Mitsubishi. No different with Ford, folks. And a lot of these cars are assembled in Brazil. All the parts are made in Asia, assembled in Brazil. Shipped to the United States, sold to Americans. Yeah. You wonder where your jobs went? Ask Bob Dole. Ask Bill Clinton. Ask Rush Limbaugh. Who supported NAFTA and GATT? Whole scale desertion of manufacturing from this country to third world nations. Supported by so-called conservative Americans who care about the status of the American worker.
And a long-term rule. Everybody knows. Everybody knows. Everybody knows. That's how it goes.
Yes, folks, everybody knows, but most people are too intimidated, too afraid to speak up or to do anything, except those of us who some of you claim don't know any better. Well, we do, folks. You see, we subscribe to the principles and ideals which made this nation the greatest nation in the history of the entire world. Thomas Jefferson said, "The tree of liberty must be from time to time fertilized with the blood of patriots and tyrants." That's correct. When Benjamin Franklin came out of Constitutional Hall after they had completed the signing of the document known as the Constitution for the United States of America, he was asked, "Ben, what have ye wrought?" Well, old Ben looked at him with a jaundiced eye and said, "A republic, if you can keep it." Seems today that there are only a few of us who really want to keep it. The rest of you are rushing blindly into the darkness. Down the path, you haven't got the slightest idea what you're going to run into, stumble over, or fall over. But you see, that's only because you haven't studied history. You don't understand who's bringing this about, what they believe in, and why they're doing it. Those of us who do also know that to ignore the lessons of history is to repeat them over and over and over again. If you want to know what's coming, look at the history of socialism and communism. But that is exactly what it is. Haven't you wondered why all of a sudden everybody on the television and everybody in Washington, D.C. has taken to calling this a democracy? Talking about the great democracy and the democracy of this great nation and democracy this and democracy that. Democracy, 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 democracy. If you've studied the history of this nation, you'd know that it is not a democracy, never was intended to be. It's a constitutional republic based upon checks and balances. And the only place where there was supposed to be any democracy whatsoever was in the election of the House of Representatives. The president is not elected by the people, never was and never will be. He's elected by the Electoral College. And the Electoral College does not have to vote the way the people vote, and never have had to. Most of you, even though you've gone through all of the 12 years of elementary school, middle school, and high school, and many of you have completed 4 or more years of college, you still don't know those things. It's a constitutional republic. One of the major steps towards the destruction of the sovereignty of the states and the garnering of more, and I mean much more power, by the federal government, which was never intended by the Founding Fathers, was taking away the right of the state legislatures to appoint the senators of the states to the United States Senate. and causing them to be elected by the populace. You see, believe it or not, and you can argue this point till you're blue in the face, and many of you will take exception to it, the general public, ladies and gentlemen, when it comes to electing the right people to represent them in the federal government, haven't got the slightest idea what they're doing and never have had. And that's the truth. It's the hard truth. But nevertheless, it is the truth. Most people vote Democrat or Republican simply because their parents did. None of them usually know anything whatsoever about the candidate they're voting for other than, well, he looked better than the other guy on television. Morals don't even make any difference today. You all voted for Clinton, and that's probably the most immoral man who's ever occupied the White House in the history of this country. The morals don't mean anything. I guess that nothing does. V.I. Lenin, the founder of the Soviet Union, a communist, a Marxist, said, and I quote, "Democracy is indispensable to socialism," end quote. And why are these communists always talking about socialism? Because that's what communism is. Marx and Engels made no bones about it in their writings. They said the end goal of socialism is communism. And we're rushing right into socialism head over heels right now, ladies and gentlemen. If you believe that the fall of the Soviet Union was legitimate, and if you believe that communism is dead, read Alexander Golitsyn's books. Read them. He warned us many, many years ago when nobody was listening. James Jesus Angleton, the big high muckety muck guardian of the secrets of the Central Intelligence Agency, told everybody that Alexander Golitsyn was lying when he told us the strategy of the communist world was to create a supposed death of communism, a breakup of the Soviet Union, which would then disarm the West, which would destroy the United States from within and create a socialist one-world government. Well, for many years, ladies and gentlemen, in fact, ever since the end of World War II, they've been looking for the high-ranking mole in the Central Intelligence Agency that was creating the ability for the Illuminati, the world socialist body, to destroy the United States from within. And I'm here to tell you right now, that man was James Jesus Angleton. You can bet everything you have on it, you'll win. Read Alexander Golitsyn. He outlined everything that was to happen in the fall of the Soviet Union, the disarmament of the West, the bringing together of the nations of the world under a socialist totalitarian United Nations. Nikita Khrushchev in the United Nations back in the 50s, I remember, I saw it on television as a boy, sat at his desk in the United Nations when he was visiting the United Nations from the Soviet Union and pounded. He took off his shoe and pounded his shoe on the desk and screamed at the world, "We do not have to invade the United States. We will destroy you from within." He was right. Nobody paid any attention to him. Not too long after that, he was relieved of his position because he wasn't supposed to tell that to the world. Somebody else took his place. And the infiltration and the destruction from within continued and continues today. As a young man, when all American citizens were forbidden to travel to the Soviet Union, to any place behind the Iron Curtain, William Jefferson Clinton had no problem, as a college student, traveling to Moscow, where he received special training. In Europe, He was a socialist Marxist instigator of riots and demonstrations against the United States of America. Didn't know that about him, did you? Did you know that Hillary Clinton, throughout her life, has donated large sums of money to Marxist socialist organizations and groups, some of them which openly practice and openly and readily admit to terrorist acts throughout the world? This is no secret to those who have studied her background. Do you know why they call our forces the United Nations peacekeeping forces? Because Marx and Lenin both defined peace as, and I quote, the elimination of all opposition to socialism, end quote. How about that? Did you know that many years ago there was a document written by the United States State Department called State Department Publication 7277 with an introduction by Harry Truman, who admitted in that introduction that the stated and avowed policy of the United States government is to create a world government? And in that document, it outlined in three stages the bringing together of the military forces of the Soviet Union and the United States to create a police force of peacekeepers, which would be the only military force in the world under the United Nations. Did you know that NATO was created as a United Nations force under the auspices of the United Nations Charter, and that the Warsaw Pact was also created as a United Nations force under the auspices of the United Nations Charter? That was stage one. We are now in stage two, where NATO is bringing in the Warsaw military forces, the Warsaw Pact military forces, into the NATO organization. Until this unification is completed, the military forces of the United States are acting as the world police body, the peacekeeping forces for the United Nations. How many of you know that the United States created the United Nations? Members of the delegation of the United States wrote the United Nations Charter, and it's almost an exact carbon copy of the Constitution of the old Soviet Union. Who pays most of the money to foot the bills for the United Nations? The United States of America. We're behind in our payments, but nevertheless, we're the ones who foot the biggest portion of all of the payments. Where does all the money come from that's being flooded into the Asian nations to try to stem the economic collapse? Now, that's what they're telling you, but the truth is, they're pumping that money into the Asian nations, knowing full well that they can't stop it from collapsing, but that the pumping of that money will help create the inflationary terror that will destroy the economy of the United States of America in the near future. Where does all that money come from, ladies and gentlemen? The International Monetary Fund is pumping it out, but who's pumping it into them? As usual, it is the United States of America, always has been, always will be. The International Monetary Fund is not a business. It's an arm of the United Nations. Did you know that the Secretary of the Treasury of the Treasury Department of the United States of America is the Governor General of the International Monetary Fund? Were you aware of that? Well, of course not. No. There's nobody in your high schools or colleges who teaches you this stuff because they don't want you to know it. You're not supposed to know it. If you knew all this stuff, you could not be so easily controlled and destroyed. But it's all there for anybody who wants to look. all of it. Nothing is hidden. There are no secrets. Believe this, if you never believe anything else in your entire life, ladies and gentlemen, there are no secrets. It's all out in the open. Believe this also, you idiots who join organizations and they tell you right up front, you'll never know anything about those organizations until after you become a member and taken a blood oath. I'm talking about the fraternal organizations and secret societies that many of you belong to. That's pretty stupid to join something you don't know anything about. And they tell you right to your face, you're not going to know anything about it until you've committed yourself and taken blood oaths. And don't tell me that crap that you spout that the oaths don't mean anything. They're just ceremonies. Grown men don't take oaths that don't mean anything. If your oath doesn't mean anything when you take it in the lodge, it doesn't mean anything in court, on a witness stand, or anywhere else in your life. Maybe that's an admission of your true nature and your true character. An honorable man does not take an oath of any kind unless he means it. Listen to me. There are no secrets. The only secret in the lodge, if you get to the highest degrees, is how to use the promise of a secret to control all of those idiots down below. How do you like that? Makes you mad, doesn't it? Well, write me a letter. Write me a letter. Yes, sir. Like the IRS said, we're here to help you. Send us a fax. Write me a letter. Love to hear from you. Don't you just know it? And speaking of hearing from you, if there's anybody in the Great Plains, the Northwest, the Northeast, or the Southwest, who is listening to this broadcast and would like to give me a reception report, I would like to know if you can hear this broadcast on shortwave, please call 520-333-4578 right now and let me know. That's 520-333-4578 and let me know so that I can tell if this earlier time is doing us good. I already know this is doing good in Wisconsin, where they couldn't even hear it last week. And in Miami, where this is really strange, if you're close to a shortwave station, you usually can't hear anything they're broadcasting because shortwave skips right over a close proximity area. And the transmitter is in Miami. So it's nice to know that we're coming in loud and clear in Miami. And in Wisconsin. I would like to know if we're coming in loud and clear anywhere else. If you're bashful and you don't want to call in on the air, call this same number tomorrow and either talk to me or leave a message on the answering machine because I really want to know. I need to know. Or send me email. You can send me email at harvest@harvest-trust.org. You see, we have our own domain on the internet. And that reminds me, let me give out the internet web page address, because it's one of the biggest, most information-packed web pages that there is. It is a researcher's dream, and there's a place on there, there's a forum where you can talk to other people and all that kind of stuff. Hopefully soon we'll have a chat room. We're working on that. The address is harvest-trust.org. You don't need www. All you need is http://harvest-trust.org. Now, tomorrow, folks, we're going to talk about the Constitution for the United States of America. We're going to talk a lot about it over the next couple of weeks. Most of you have never read it, don't own one, have never seen one, except maybe a picture in a book of the original Constitution, which is extremely difficult to read even when it's its original size, simply because of the archaic style of handwriting back in those days, and it's not printed, it's handwritten. So, aside from seeing a picture of it, most of you have never seen one, never read one. They don't teach it in our schools anymore. Those of us who were in school when it was taught generally didn't pay too much attention. We all took everything for granted around here. So on this broadcast, we're going to get into the Constitution and the Bill of Rights and the amendments. We're going to talk about it. We're going to study it. Oh, yes. And we're going to talk about this treasonous art of interpreting the writings of geniuses who were so careful in the selection and the meaning of the words that they chose that they left absolutely no room for interpretation whatsoever. And in the early days of this country, there were no interpretations of the Constitution. Everybody understood exactly what it meant. Nope, that didn't start until this century. In the 1900s, people began to say that they could interpret the Constitution. One of the reasons is that most people don't know the original meanings of the words that existed when those words were written. They also don't understand that words in their legal context generally and usually have a completely different meaning than they do in the popular vernacular. So when you're talking to your friends or at work or making a speech somewhere, you're using meanings of words that have an entirely different meaning in a legal dictionary, in a court of law, in a document like the Constitution for the United States, and a lot of other things. The best way to determine the meaning of the words written in the Constitution for the United States of America, the Bill of Rights, and in the laws passed by Congress is to obtain an 1828 Webster's Dictionary. All of the meanings were the same up to that point. After that, they began to change. 1828 Webster's Dictionary. You can do a search on the World Wide Web and come up with a place to order it. And you may be able to order one from your local bookstore because it is in print. Yo, yes, sir. We're starting to reprint a lot of books that a lot of people don't want reprinted nowadays. And you can get some of the most important accumulations of the sum total of all of the knowledge of the human race now that they have been trying to destroy and keep from you for many, many years. The library is no longer such a great place. You'll find that many of the most important books in this country's history are disappearing from the shelves of the libraries throughout the country, along with early law books that knew what the Constitution said. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. Pat in Connecticut.
Hi, Pat. How are you?
Good. How's everything?
It's okay. Let me put it that way. Yeah?
It was nothing at all.
Do you have this now?
It's on now, but it fades in and out.
Okay.
From, like, really good to unintelligible.
Do you have an outside antenna?
No.
Okay, that's what you really need until they get the new antenna going, which I understand is not going to be too far in the future.
Good. Well, it's great to hear you again anyway.
Thanks, Pat. You coming to this year's conference?
I'm planning on it.
Well, I hope you do. Good.
Okay, I'll be talking to you.
Thank you for your reception report. You're in Connecticut, right?
That's right.
Thank you.
Okay, good to hear you again, Bill.
Good night.
Bye.
That's Pat. Pat C. I recognize her voice. From Connecticut. She was at our last conference in 1997. By the way, our next conference is in May of this year. It's going to be the week of Labor Day. And if you want to come, you better start making your vacation plans and getting your money together. Good evening. You're on the air.
This is Monica Tingle calling from California, and I'm calling to give you a signal report. We've got about S2 and noise and S3 otherwise and great modulation.
Wonderful.
So I just wanted to let you know.
Thank you very much.
We appreciate your show.
Well, I appreciate your calling in to let me know that.
All right. Well, thank you.
That's wonderful, folks. At the later time, nobody in California could get us ever. So I'm very pleased with that statement, which means that anybody in between should be getting this broadcast. And like all shortwave broadcasts, sometimes listening is an art form. I used to sit out in my backyard with my shortwave radio and have to put one hand on the antenna, one hand on a pipe in the ground, stick my leg up in the air, and let the dog sit on my foot. And that's the only way I could listen to shortwave radio. And folks, in some areas with some radios and some antennas, that is not at all an exaggeration. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, Bill. Eastern Long Island, just like the guy from Connecticut, the first part of the show was not good. Picked you up at about 8:45, and the show before you was very clear. And then right at the top of the hour, massive static came on. But by, like I said, I walked away from the radio at 8:23. I came back to it at 8:45, and I could hear you good talking about the Warsaw Pact.
Okay, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you.
And for those of you having that kind of reception problems, you need an outside antenna, long wire. If you don't have enough room outside, you can string it up in your house, and one of these nights I'll tell you how to do that. But we're out of time, folks. So, I want to thank you all for being here with me once again for the hour of the time. Good night, and God bless each and every single one of you.